Welcome to the lecture series on EC354. That is the subject code. The name of the subject is microprocessors. In lecture 1, we have gone through the introduction of the microprocessor. In the introductory part, we have gone through a programmable machine. We have seen where the microprocessor is being used as far as applications are concerned. After doing that, we have gone through microprocessor as a CPU. In that, we have seen a block diagram of a microcomputer, and from that we have gone through the block diagram of a microprocessor based computer and a microcontroller. After going through that, we had discussed how exactly the microprocessor works, and in that we have gone through these three words, that is fetch, decode and execute. And then we had gone through the definitions of hardware, software and firmware. So that much we had done in the introductory part. So today we are going further in the same introduction to the microprocessor in the lecture 2. So today we are supposed to start with memory. We will discuss the basics of the memory. Now, normally in computers, memory is being used for the storage of data, for the storage of programs which will run inside the computer, or for the storage of the intermediate results as well as the final results which is being generated after computation. Now, as in the first lecture, we had seen that the 8085 microprocessor, it basically runs at some frequency. Or if we take an example of a computer, then nowadays the working frequency of the microprocessor used in today's computers, that is in gigahertz. So the memory which are being available for a computer, like primary memory and the secondary memory, if we talk about a computer, then we do have a primary memory and a secondary memory. We do have a primary memory and a secondary memory. Now, the working frequency of the computer is quite large, and we do have primary memory for the temporary storage of the data, and the permanent storage of the programs, we do have the secondary memory. So when the microprocessor communicates with this memory for reading or writing of data or programs from the memory, it will take some time. So basically, to speed up the process, there is a concept of cache memory in the computers, which will work as a bridge between the microprocessor and the primary and secondary memory. So the cache memory compensates the speed which is being required, because the primary memory and the secondary memory both are not that much faster, they are slower, and the working frequency of the microprocessor is much more higher. So to cope up the speed, concept of cache memory is there in the computers, so which will work as a bridge between the primary memory or secondary memory and the microprocessor. So the cache memory initially take the instructions or data from the main memory of the computer, and when it is being required by the microprocessor, that is being provided. So that is the working of the cache memory in a computer. Primary memory, like we are having RAM for the temporary storage of data or the intermediate storage of results, and the secondary memory can be hard disk, optical disk, or the other means by which we can permanently store the data. Okay, so in a computer there is a concept of cache memory, primary memory, and a secondary memory. Okay, so let us proceed further. Basically, the memory can be classified, a kind of memory can be written as a semiconductor, a semiconductor memory. So a semiconductor memory is of two types. That is, the first type is RAM, that is random access memory, and the second type is ROM, that is read only memory. Now this random access memory are volatile in nature, means the data stored in the random access memory are for the temporary storage of the data. The read-only memory is non-volatile in nature, means the data can be permanently stored in read-only memory. Now let us first go through in detail regarding the random access memory. Let us go through in detail regarding the random access memory. Now, random access memory can be of two types. Random access memory can be of two types. So we are having SRAM, that is a static RAM, and we are having a DRAM, that is a dynamic RAM. So there are two types of RAMs available in market. One is the static RAM and the other one is the dynamic RAM. The working of both the static RAM as well as dynamic RAM is the same. Both are being used for the temporary storage of data. So the main difference is in the construction of the individual RAM. In case of static RAM, its packaging density is quite high, because one memory cell is consist of 6 transistors in SRAM. A memory cell is nothing but a smallest unit of a memory which can store a bit of information. Means a memory cell can store 0 or 1. Okay, so that is the SRAM. The packaging density is quite high. On the other hand, we are having DRAM, that is dynamic RAM. Its packaging density is quite low, because one memory cell is made up of only one transistor. But the disadvantage of a DRAM is that even if the power is on, it needs a refresh and control circuitry to retain the data. The reason behind that in DRAM is that the construction of DRAM comprising of capacitors. So to retain the data, capacitor continuously requires refresh and control circuit. That is not the case in SRAM. So SRAMs are much more faster than DRAM, but DRAM's packaging density is quite high. So if you are going with larger size of memories, then you will get in DRAM. Okay, for smaller and faster size of memory, you will get in SRAM. Okay, so let us go through the types again. DRAM is again having some types. The first one in DRAM is IRAM. IRAM is nothing but the integrated RAM. In IRAM, whatever the refresh and control circuitry required for the DRAM is being integrated into a single chip. That is the reason why the name is IRAM, that is integrated RAM. After IRAM, the next type of memory is our SDRAM. That is asynchronous DRAM, means whatever the data transfer that will occur in synchronization with the clock pulse which is being given to the microprocessor. So whatever the data which is being given, that data will be in synchronization with the clock pulse of the system. After SDRAM, we are having SGRAM, that is the synchronous graphic RAM, which is being used. That is the synchronous graphic RAM which is being used for graphics application. After SGRAM, the next type of DRAM that we are having, that is DDR SDRAM. Its functionality is same as SDRAM, but the difference is that, as the name suggests, that is double data rate. The data rate for SDRAM is just double than that of the SDRAM. That is due to the functioning of the DDR SDRAM. The DDR SDRAM initially, whatever the clock pulse that is being given to the DDR SDRAM, it will work on both low to high as well as a high to low transition. On both transition, the data can be transferred in DDR RAM. So the data rate will be doubled as that of SDRAM. That's why the name is double data rate SDRAM. And the fastest RAM which is being available in today's market is RDRAM. That is nothing but a RAMBUS DRAM. Okay, so that is the fastest DRAM available in market today. Its data transfer rate is 1.6 gigabytes per second. So that much speed can be achieved by RAMBUS DRAM. Okay, so that is all about DRAM, and these are the different DRAMs available in market. So after DRAM, DRAM and SRAM, let us go with the ROM. So RAM we had concluded. In semiconductor memory, we had gone through the RAM part. Now let us go with the ROM. That is nothing but the read-only memory. Okay? For the permanent storage of data, we use read-only memory. Now see that the types of ROM we are having, the first one is PROM, that is a programmable ROM. Okay, means they are one time programmable. So initially in earlier development phase, the PROMs are being used for the permanent storage of the data, and they are only one time programmable memory. Okay, after PROM we are having an EPROM. They are erasable programmable ROM. A typical example of an EPROM is a UVPROM. Normally in earlier days, these EPROMs are available with ultraviolet eraser. Means to program this kind of memory, that is EPROM, electrical signals are being given, so it can be programmed by sequentially. To remove the program from that particular memory, UV source is being required. So that chip is being exposed to the UV source for 20 minutes. So all the data inside that, all the data inside that memory will be erased. Okay? So the time consumed for erasing the data is typically 20 to 25 minutes in EPO. So there is advancement, and further we are having EEPO or E square PO, that is electrically erasable and programmable PROMs, or electrically alterable ROMs. Okay, and finally we are having flash memory. It is electrically erasable as well as programmable, and it is inherently non-volatile memory. Unlike E square ROM, the packaging density for the flash ROM is quite high. That is why it is being used in microcontrollers as ROM. So different sizes of flash memory is available inside the microcontroller chip that can be used for the program application. The name flash arrived from the electrically erasing and reprogramming of the chip that can be done in a moment of seconds or in a flash. That's why the name is being given as flash memory. There is one more kind of NVRAM that is being used by the last 5000 series of microcontrollers, that is NVRAM. So they are non-volatile RAMs nowadays available inside microcontrollers, which will work as ROM. So they can be electrically erasable and reprogrammable memory, but the cost of NVRAM is much more than the flash memories. So normally in industries people will choose high density memory like flash, which is inbuilt inside the microcontrollers. Okay, so this is all about the ROM and the different types of ROM. So that is the semiconductor memory that we have gone through. So that is all about the semiconductor memory. Now if we talk about the memory, there is one more concept that we are supposed to learn when we are learning a microprocessor. So there is a concept of program memory and data memory. There is a concept of program memory and data. So basically, normally in a microcontroller based system, there is a concept of a program memory and a data memory. Program memory is nothing but it resembles ROM. That is read-only memory. It means whatever the programs or the binary instructions which are being provided to the microcontroller or the microprocessor to perform a certain task, that is being in program memory. And the RAM will be depicted as data memory. So for the temporary storage of data, all the data will be stored in the data memory. So data memory will retain data, program memory will retain binary instructions to perform that task. Okay. So there is a concept of program memory and data memory. So let us proceed further. That's all we have in brief regarding the memory. Later on we'll go through the designing part also. So right now in the introductory lecture I'm just briefing the memory. So let us proceed further with the next topic, that is buses. But in this we will go through 8085. Let us go through the buses, and in that we will consider the microprocessor that we are going to learn, that is the 8085 microprocessor. Now as the name suggests, buses. So normally buses are being used for transportation. as you know, and you are using it in your day-to-day life for transportation. In context of microprocessor, the buses are doing the same thing. Means they are being used to transfer address from one place to other place inside the microprocessor, as well as to the external peripherals, or it can be used to transfer data, or it can be used to transfer some control signals. Okay. So basically, buses are nothing but the collection of wires or a group of wires which are being used for the transfer of data or address or control signals from microprocessor to memory, or memory to microprocessor, or microprocessor to IO device, and vice versa. Okay, so when I say buses, it is nothing but set of wires which are being used for the communication between the microprocessor and the peripherals. Okay, so basically in 8085 microprocessor there are three types of buses. So in 8085 we are having address bus, we do have a data bus and a control bus. So we are having three buses in 8085 microprocessor. Okay, that is the address bus, a data bus, and a control bus. So let us first go through the address bus in detail. Now, to access the memory, the address bus is required. So the microprocessor puts the address on the address bus, which will point to that address or the memory location of the memory from where the data or the binary instruction is to be fetched, or the data is to be read or write. So address bus will take only address, and the direction of the address bus is only from microprocessor to memory. It will point that particular memory location, or in case of IO device, it will point the address of that IO port. So address bus is always unidirectional. Keep in mind that address bus is always unidirectional. Means it there is only one way from microprocessor to memory as far as the address bus is concerned. In 8085, it is of 16 bits. When I say 16 bits, means total 16 wires are there. Each wire can have one bit of address. So the address in 8085, that is made up of 16 bits. Okay, so the address range for 8085 microprocessor, if we take 16 bits, then it will be 0000H in hexadecimal. If we take, that is 2FFFFH. That is 2FFFFH. Okay, or we can do 2 raised to 16. Okay, so we will get, that is 64K of data of memory can be accessed. So 64K is 65536. So that much memory locations can be accessed by 8085 microprocessor. Okay, so that is the memory range, the maximum allowable memory which can be interfaced 2N8085 microprocessor. It depends on address bus. Okay? It depends on the address bus. So, if we take an example that if we are having a 256K bytes of memory, if we are having a 256K bytes of memory, then how many address lines are required? So for that, we need to take K as 2 raised to 10. K is nothing but 2 raised to 10, that is 1024. That is multiplied by 2 raised to 8, that is 256, that much bytes. Okay, so it will become 2 raised to 18. So how many address lines are there? 18. We are having 18 address lines. So for a memory of 256K bytes, there are 18 address lines which are being required. In 8085, we are having only 16 address lines. So the maximum amount of memory which can be interfaced to an 8085 microprocessor is limited to 2 raised to 16, that is 64K. Okay? And in hexadecimal, the memory range will be from 0000H to FFFFH. Okay? So that is all about the address bus. Let us proceed further with the data bus. Now see that as far as the data bus is there in 8085, there are only 8 wires, so it is of 8 bits. Only 8 bits, 8 wires are there. As the data can flow from microprocessor to memory, memory to microprocessor, or a microprocessor to peripherals, or peripherals to microprocessors. Okay? So it will be a bidirectional bus. It will be a bidirectional bus. Okay? It's a two-way bus, that's why it is being a bidirectional bus, but at a time only one way is possible in 8085 microprocessor. Now see that as it is a 8-bit bus, so we are having 2 raised to 8, that is how much? We will get 256, or we will have 0 to 255 total. The data will be 0 to 255, or the range will be from 00H to FFH. So the data manipulating capability of an 8085 microprocessor is only 8 bits. If the final result goes beyond the limit of 8 bit, then it will be efficiently manipulated by the programmer, or it will be taken care by the programmer. So if the result will go beyond FFH, then one more byte is being required to handle that data. Okay, that we will see when we go through the different programs. Okay, instead of 8 bit, if we are going for 16 bit, then how we are going to handle the data, because the data handling capability of this microprocessor is only 8 bit, because the data bus is of 8 bit, and that is the reason we call it as an 8 bit microprocessor. That is the reason why we call the 8085 microprocessor as an 8 bit microprocessor. Okay? So, as far as data bus is concerned, it is of 8 bits, it is bidirectional. The maximum allowable value which can be manipulated, that is 2 raised to 8, so that is 0 to 255, and that is from 00H to FFH in hexadecimal. Okay. So let us proceed further with the control bus. Now see that whenever the microprocessor communicates with a peripheral or a memory. There are few control signals in 8085 microprocessor which will work in synchronization with the with that communication process. So there is a need of a timing and control block inside the microprocessor which will take care or which will control this communication mechanism. So basically in 8085 microprocessor, for an example, we are having IO or memory control signal. We do have a read and a write control signal. Okay, there are many control signals available in the 8085 microprocessor. So later on, when we go through the block diagram and the pinout diagram of the 8085 microprocessor, we will see the control signals. Okay, now as far as the bus is concerned, depending on the signal, it can be unidirectional or it can be bidirectional. So it depends on the signal which is being carried out by the control bus. So depending on the signal, it can be unidirectional or it can be a bidirectional control signal. Okay, so that is all about the buses. Okay. That is all about the buses. Now let us proceed further with the processing speed of a processor. Processing speed of a processor. Normally the processing speed of a processor is being calculated or expressed in MIPS, that is millions of instructions per second. Okay, and how exactly the processor is executing the fixed point or the floating point instructions. Okay, the speed will depend on the millions of instructions per second, that how much instruction, how much million of instructions can be executed by a particular processor in 1 second. Okay, so that is being expressed in MIPS. So after going through this, let us proceed further with the architecture of computer. Okay, so let us go with the first architecture of computer, that is von Neumann. Architecture of computer. Now John von Neumann gave the idea of basic organization of a digital computer in 1945. It was evolved. Basically the architecture is like that, that the program memory and the data memory, that will be in the same continuous block. Like in 8085 microprocessor, we do have the program memory and the data memory in the same continuous block, and that block, the maximum size is 64K. So in the 64K, both RAM as well as ROM, we are supposed to interface. Okay, so as it is a 64K, so we can go with the different sizes of 1K, 2K, 8K, 16K or 32. So at max we can go with the 32K of RAM and 32K of ROM in 8085 microprocessor. So they are in a continuous block. So if we talk about a memory, then normally we visualize the memory like boxes or a stack of boxes. Okay, we visualize memory as a stack of boxes. Each box each box, to access each box. That box must have some address, only then it can be accessed. So we had gone through the address bus. So using the address bus, each box can be accessed. And in 8085, every box can have only 8 bit of data, so only 1 byte. So that byte can be transferred using the data bus. So that is how the memory will look like in a microprocessor based system. So if we talk about the von Neumann architecture, then the program and data memory is a part of the same continuous block, means that two memories cannot have the same address. Okay, one part, for an example, one part is over here, the other part is over here. Okay, so that is the von Neumann architecture. The other computer architecture is the Harvard architecture. In Harvard architecture, the program memory and data memory both are treated separately. Okay, so normally in some microprocessors and typically in microcontrollers, the program memory and data memory are separate, means they are not a part of a continuous block, means they do have same addresses, means both can start with the zeroth location. Okay, so in Harvard architecture, the program memory and data memory are separate. Okay, so that is the two architecture, von Neumann architecture and Harvard architecture. Nowadays the third architecture came for the computer, that is a data flow architecture. As the name suggests, the data will flow fluently to microprocessor, because in the data flow architecture there is no program counter. So bunch of data will be fetched from the memory, a bunch of binary instructions are being fetched from the memory at a time, and when it is being required by the microprocessor, it is being provided. So in the data flow architecture, there is no concept of a program counter. There is no program counter in data flow architecture. So whenever the binary instructions are being required, they are already being fetched from the memory and they are waiting for the microprocessor. So whenever it is being required, they are being provided. So these are the three computer architectures. We are having von Neumann architecture, Harvard architecture and the data flow architecture. Okay. So that is all we have for today's lecture. So in the next lecture, we will conclude the introductory part for the microprocessor. So that comprising of the types of the processors, and then we will go for the evolution of the microprocessors, and finally we will conclude the introductory part. After the evolution, we will go for a typical temperature controller system or a microprocessor based temperature controller system. So we will see, using a microprocessor, how a typical application can be made. Okay, so we will take that first three lectures for the introductory part, and then we will proceed further to the architecture.